In Europe, offshore wind farms are relatively common. But in the US, offshore wind power is still pretty new, and there are no offshore wind farms in the Great Lakes. But a project called Icebreaker, proposed for Lake Erie just off of Cleveland, could change that.
Jade Davis represents Lake Erie Energy Development Corporation, or LEEDCO, a public-private partnership in Cleveland that has joined with Norwegian industry leader Fred Olsen Renewables to develop the Icebreaker Wind Project.
Icebreaker is a demonstration project that is designed to demonstrate how we could possibly create large-scale energy from offshore wind here in the Great Lakes, but specifically in Lake Erie.
The name Icebreaker hints at one of the big obstacles of the project, building offshore turbines that can withstand the annual freezing of Lake Erie.
We tend to get ice in this part of Great Lakes, all the Great Lakes in the wintertime, and these turbines will have to be able to withstand and break ice on their own.
Compared to large offshore wind farms already in place in Europe, Icebreaker is modest, just 6 480-foot turbines producing 20.7 megawatts. But while the scale of Icebreaker is small, its impact could be huge.
If we're talking about climate change, renewable energy is going to be needed, more energy is just going to be needed, and that's what this project is going to be providing. But it's also, more importantly, going to provide science and data that will help us make good, informed energy generation decisions, especially when we're thinking about our greatest natural resource, which is Lake Erie.
To gather the science and data, and to satisfy various requirements from state and federal regulators, LEEDCO has conducted many environmental studies. Ed Verhamy is a senior engineer at Limnotech, an environmental consulting firm. He led the initial research team.
When you look at the Icebreaker project, we started to divide some of the environmental issues into above the water and below the water. So our work was looking at all the activities of the project that would impact the lake, whether it was during construction or whether it was during operations.
Verhamy and his team's research included evaluating water and sediment quality, tracking fish migration, monitoring bat activity, and understanding what happens when the lake freezes. But some say their research isn't enough. The Lake Erie Foundation is against the Icebreaker project. Board member John Lipi explains their position.
The Lake Erie Foundation is about Lake Erie. And so we're not about choosing winners or losers with energy policy. We just follow the science. And in this case, there's not enough science, there's not enough data to support building industrial wind turbines in Lake Erie.
According to Lipi, the foundation's concerns include the cost of the project, the impact on migratory birds, and the fallout of disrupting potentially toxic sediment during construction.
When the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers dredged the Cuyahoga River for decades and decades, they just dumped the toxic sediment out into the lake. And one of the things that we know is that construction of something like a wind turbine out in the lake will disturb that toxic sediment.
Verhamy says concerns about toxic sediment were also shared by his team. But their research concluded that no Icebreaker turbines or the buried cables that connect each turbine to the power grid will be located in areas known to contain toxic sediment. Verhamy also says offshore construction isn't a new concept on the lake.
All of these activities happen on the Great Lakes already in terms of building bridges, putting in foundations, burying power cables to islands. So we did have a lot of referential impact work to look at. When we look at that, I think that there was little to no impact.
On the Atlantic seaboard, offshore wind is already a reality. The first offshore wind farm built in the U.S. is located here at Block Island off the coast of Rhode Island. Alex Kuffner, environment reporter for the Providence Journal, has reported on the project from the beginning.
The project was initially proposed around the same time as Icebreaker, actually, and it took, you know, the better part of a decade to get the approvals to get built. There were a number of concerns. One was cost. The second sort of area of opposition had to do with you know, the views. These turbines, even though they're far off the mainland shore of Rhode Island, they're very close to the Block Island shore.
Despite these concerns, the project was completed in 2016. In the time since, have the rosy promises or the dire warnings come true? In terms of energy production, Block Island promised to generate 30 megawatts of energy, enough to power 17,000 homes. Kuffner says the amount of energy generated fluctuates.
So in certain years, the project has produced actually more power than they promised, because it turned out that the turbines were a little bit more efficient than they thought, that the winds were stronger. But then in, you know, recently, some of the turbines had to go down for maintenance.
Prior to construction, some predicted that coveted fishing grounds would be disrupted. According to Kuffner, that didn't happen. The turbines were strategically placed to avoid a negative impact. And while new jobs were mainly limited to temporary construction positions, the local charter boat industry is enjoying a healthy uptick in business.
The guys that have small boats that are taking people out to, you know, do rod and reel fishing, they love the wind farm because you've created this reef effect around the bases of the turbines, and that attracts fish. You know, if they have clients and they've had an unsuccessful day out, they stop by the Block Island Wind Farm because they know they'll catch something there.
Back in Ohio, John Lippi and his colleagues at Lake Erie Foundation are concerned about the precedent Icebreaker could set. They worry that it would lead to widespread wind turbine development on Lake Erie.
The developers for Icebreaker have stated on multiple occasions that their goal is to generate 5,000 megawatts of electricity out of Lake Erie by the year 2030. And to do that, they would need to build about 1,400 to 1,600 wind turbines in Lake Erie. Having 1,500 wind turbines in Lake Erie would be devastating to all of us who love Lake Erie.
But LEEDCO spokesperson Davis says any future offshore wind plans would need to be independently reviewed and approved.
LEEDCO is not a blanket permit to outfit Lake Erie and the waters of Lake Erie with wind turbines.
One thing is clear, though. Offshore wind development along New York's roughly 75 miles of Lake Erie coastline seems unlikely. In December, New York State released a long-awaited feasibility report, which concludes that the benefits of offshore wind on Lake Erie don't outweigh the risks and costs. It seems likely that the benefits, risks, and costs of offshore wind in the Great Lakes will be a topic of debate for some time. No energy solution is perfect. All of them have pros and cons, so there's no zero-impact option available. The choice is between which impacts seem most acceptable.
If you accept climate science, right, we have to reduce our carbon emissions. We have to, you know, wean ourselves off fossil fuels. Offshore wind is key to doing that.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for our newsletter at greatlakesnow.org.